Bob. I think perhaps the really amazing point is where the inner sciences meet the outer sciences.
Uh-huh. Great.
Because, you know, we have external technology. We have a science of medicine. We have science of building, science of so many external things. Mm-hmm. But the way that, you know, as you described, the way that we currently study and look at them is from a completely external way. And I think a unique aspect of Sowa Rigpa, the Tibetan science of healing, is that it looks at this body, you know, your own body, another's body, which is an external science, but from the perspective that's rooted in this inner science.
Mm-hmm.
So it sees us having a body, having life, but coming from this continuum of consciousness, coming from an empty universe, coming from a reality of karma as the causative agent behind, you know, creating phenomena.
Mm-hmm.
And so that has amazing implications in how medicine sees the world. You know, of course, Tibetan medicine, Sowa Rigpa, is, you know, an amazing clinical, skillful medical system. And, you know, that's, of course, incredible. But I think another really amazing thing is that it is so deeply linked to the inner science.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, even the word Sowa Rigpa itself, right, which is the Tibetan word for the science of healing, you know, comes from the Sanskrit chikitsa vidya,
mm-hmm.
you know, like the knowledge or science of healing, of therapy, of cure. You know, Dr. Nita always likes to say that that itself has kind of an inner and an outer meaning. So you can see Sowa Rigpa, you know, the science of healing, the knowledge of healing, as an outer science, but you can also see it as an inner science.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, you know, the word Sowa, which means to heal or to nourish, to give a therapy to, and the word Rigpa means, you know, a knowledge, a science, or just knowledge itself. So normally we say it's the science or knowledge of healing, but also it means that your own innate essence of consciousness is healing.
Mm.
That there is a healing aspect to awareness itself. And I think that is
That's
the inner science
cool.
of, you know, what you're saying, this depth psychology, and how just being aware of the nature and the essence of your mind,
mm-hmm.
and how thoughts and emotions unfold and unravel, you know, is healing nature in itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so the sciences of Sowa Rigpa really incorporate all of that together. And I think that's one thing that's very unique that really you can't find in any other medical tradition.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying Ayurveda, Chinese medicine, other medicines don't have that component, but
mm-hmm.
it's not as direct.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there's a yogic tradition and a medical tradition, and there's some intersection point, but it's not in the text, it's not in the classical
mm-hmm.
tradition. But in Sowa Rigpa, it's very linked together.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think this outer science of healing, you know, we have to start from the inner science.
Mm-hmm.
We have to start from the understanding of the nature of reality.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the first
thing
I think.
Very
that's
very deep.
That's incredible, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, then it'll influence how we look at our bodies, how we look at healing, what
mm-hmm.
makes us sick, what makes us well.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, maybe one aspect of, you know, the key cosmological view that you find in, you know, Indian and Tibetan thought is this causality that you mentioned. You know, that there's a cause and effect, a karmic principle,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's easy to understand on a Newtonian physics kind of action having reaction level. But if you take it deeper and you look in a subtle kind of manifestation,
mm-hmm.
you know, that we have bodies because we have the cause to be born in a human body.
Mm-hmm.
And all of the things that you can apply to that. So then
mm-hmm.
how that influences medicine is very profound.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how we can find healing, we can work with not only the effects, but we can work with the causes too.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the entire world of, you know, doing various kinds of spiritual practices,
mm-hmm.
mantras, rituals, and even something simple like releasing life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your life is having a challenge. Your life span is limited. So as an antidote of that, you find some animals that are going to be killed or, you know, butchered or, you know, whatever, and then you free those beings. You know, you take some fish from the fisherman, you release them back into the water, and that is actually the causal seed for extending life. So so that will work only if it links into the inner science. So it's a beautiful thing how Tibetan medicine will incorporate all of that. And I mean, even what, you know, so there is a cause and effect for everything. And, you know, I mentioned that these subtle causes of, you know, positive and negative karmas and these things, which are very, very deep. But then, of course, it looks at everything we do as causative factors. You know, if you smoke cigarettes, that's a cause for getting lung diseases. Like, it's a very, even modern medicine is very clear with, you know, causes and effects. So, but I think Sowa Rigpa, and maybe all of the Indian sciences have a very deep understanding of various levels of causes and how they will ripple into effects that may not necessarily be immediately understood, you know, in a purely materialistic way. So, yeah, in this aspect, I think the, you know, the dialogue about how the science of healing, you know, what is unique and special and what is useful about this science of healing, I'm really so glad that we're tying it to the inner sciences. Because I think so often this natural medicine systems, they try so hard to link with the material modern sciences. We need to prove and verify that, you know, this plant compound cures this Western medically diagnosed disease.
Oh,
and
yes.
Then we've verified, see, it's not just nonsense. But I think this discussion is also, you know, perhaps even more valid because this can take all of the outer sciences and bring them to meet the inner sciences.
Actually, Yi Xie Zhen used to describe side effects of some of the pharmaceutical medicines as opposed to some of the herbal preparations that have 35 different herbs. And also they are connected to their occurrence in the nature. And he felt that when you isolate a so-called active ingredient and then concentrate it, that it tends to, the molecules of it tend to want to find things that were like its old environment. And then they draw things out that are not supposed to be drawn out of the system and create side effects. Whereas when you, his way of explaining the way of acting of the herbal medicine is that they're still close to their matrix. So they only do what you intend them to do in relation to your system, and they don't artificially imbalance you by trying to recreate an environment that you've artificially stripped them out of. It's very interesting the way you would explain it.
Oh, that's brilliant.
You made me reminded me of that.
I mean, I think so often, you know, even modern research on herbal medicine, they'll study curcumin, one chemical that's in turmeric, instead of studying turmeric.
Yes.
But from that perspective, the curcumin might be just trying to find the rest of the turmeric. So maybe its effect is actually quite different than the effect of turmeric itself.
It might be. That's true. The other thing that what you said is so deep, I thought, so Rigpa, you know, that Rigpa in a way itself is healing, you know, not science. And that there is the idea in Buddhist medicine that you have to, that it's kept foremost in the physician's mind, that it is the mind of the patient that will heal the patient. You know, ultimately, it's the enlightenment of the patient, their science, their mental awareness, and their mental strength, motivation based on their awareness of their own reality. And if you consider the deepest level of Buddhist thought, that everything is made out of the clear light of bliss, that bliss is the deepest energy of the universe. Then the health, like what holds the atoms in the skin of my palm of my hand together, is a kind of bliss between, at a super subtle level, like energy of bliss. So someone who's convinced that they're going to die, or that they're really unwell, or that their body is bad, and or their environment is oppressing them, and that everything's going to go wrong for them, then they're blocking the natural blissful knowingness of their own being at the subtle plane. Is that right? Is that fair? What you meant? I think
that's
what you made me think when you said that.
No, and it gets into why, what is that self-destructive, you know, why do we negate that blissful nature? Why do we separate ourselves from the universe? Why are we in this samsaric existence? Which is, right. And also, you know, such a deep, amazing question, yeah.
Well, I think Buddha had to rebel against his culture. I think that human cultures, at least in recorded history, and most of the ones that we know, tend to put down their individual members and tell you that you're no good, God made you, but boy, you're flawed, and you can only hope God will fix you up. And there are different versions of that in different cultures. And it's not just class things, but there are also, some elite tells that you have to obey the high priest, you have to obey the king. And then there's a cosmic king who you're just nothing but dirt under its feet. And, you know, you're worthless. And there's a general tendency of, in the legend of the medicine Buddha, this is the medicine Buddha. I think, does everyone know that? Does anybody not know about that? This is the medicine Buddha. We can't decide whether he's sapphire or he's lapis lazuli. But I think he has a sapphire radiance. How could he have lapis lazuli radiance? It's opaque in lapis lazuli. There are sort of sky blue lapis, but, bright lapis, but it's kind of opaque. Sapphire, at least, it's dark, but it's transparent to some extent. Anyway, this is Medicine Buddha, and they say that Medicine Buddha, the legend is that Shakyamuni Buddha, right, our Buddha of our era, 2,500 years ago, he was one of 1,000 sons of a king in another universe, billions of years, Big Bang to go. One king had 1,000 sons, a bunch of hardworking wives, I have to say, hardworking queens, and he said, and they all said, we're going to be all Buddhas in some universe, all together, all 1,000 of us, brothers. We're going to all be Buddhas in some universe. And sequentially, every few 1,000 years, one of us will be Buddha. And then Shakyamuni was, I don't know if he was the youngest or what he was, but he said, okay, when we do that, I want to volunteer to be on the planet that we inhabit at that time, in the time when the life is most difficult for the people, when they're really having a hard time, when they live maximum 100 years, Some of the other eras, they're living 1,000 years normally, like they're like 30 feet tall, things like that. There's natural harvest, they eat the air, or whatever. But I want to go there when things are really tough. So then they say the seven medicine Buddhas in this, and then in another universe, they said, that boy is a really brave Buddha. He's going to go be a Buddha when humans are violent. They only live 100 years. They don't listen to their wives. They're really sick all the time. They're very lowly in their expectation of life, what life can bring them. They're very frightened of things. And he's going there to be a Buddha. So we're going to come when he goes there, and we're going to inspire him to give the medicine teaching so they can have medicine, and they can, those human beings can, and they can build themselves up, and then they can study his teaching and become enlightened. We're going to help him out. So that's why there are eight medicine Buddhas. The Shakyamuni is one. They induct him into their medicine Buddha ring, the seven medicine Buddhas. And then you'll see there, he's there, and then there are seven Buddhas up above. Those are the seven medicine Buddhas. And then when he decides to teach medicine, he turns blue like that. Shakyamuni Buddha does. He turns blue. He gets the blues. Because he's looking at being sick, but he doesn't get the blues because he's sad, actually. He gets the blues because he sees the natural health in every cell of every being, but he realizes that due to their ignorance and misknowledge, they block that, right? So they don't really enjoy that blissful health that they actually have. And then his job is to help them understand that and bring that out of themselves. And that's what then the doctor, who, when you practice medicine in this tradition, you visualize that yourself as becoming one with the medicine Buddha. You sort of are, you become the oracle of the medicine Buddha if you are at the best chance, You open yourself to channel the medicine Buddha, let's say. I mean, you learn all this technical stuff, right? And this botany and all this stuff that Eric will tell you, like very complicated things, very, very scientific and rigorous. But then when you actually are in the act of trying to feel what's going wrong with the patient, you channel medicine Buddha, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, and so the Tibetan medical tradition, of course, was taught by medicine Buddha, but there was, the main teacher historically have, his name was Yutok. And Yutok had, was, you know, we believe was a complete, perfect embodiment of Medicine Buddha.
Right.
You know, that, that he was an emanation of Medicine Buddha.
Right.
So that he was, you know, a human that had completely, you know, that was completely in the state of Medicine Buddha at all times.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to the point that when he died, he just dissolved into light as the Medicine Buddha.
Mm-hmm.
So the complete enlightenment in the state of medicine. And so Yutok, he, you know, we believe he came to Earth on two incarnations. Well, actually, you can say three important incarnations.
Really?
The first one was Jivaka.
Oh, Jivaka. Oh, tell us about Jivaka.
So Jivaka was, he was an amazing, one of the most well-known old historical Indian doctors.
Uh-huh.
He was trained at Takshashila University in Pakistan, currently, under the great Atreya, who was one of, you know, the great historical...
Oh, really? You studied directly with Atreya?
With Atreya, yeah.
Where was Takshashila? In Afghanistan, right?
I think it's in Pakistan.
Pakistan, okay.
Somewhere around there.
Right.
But and that was one of the great universities of the ancient world, and maybe the one of the first.
I mean, oh, I think so. Before
6th century BC, you know.
Yeah.
And Atreya was supposedly a master at brain surgery.
Ah. Uh-huh.
And yeah, there's all kinds of wild stories about their brain surgery and
oh, no, they did that.
Various different things.
Yes.
So you know, and Jivaka then became the doctor around the community of Shakyamuni Buddha. And so he would give medicines to the Buddhist community, and he would often hang out with Shakyamuni, and they would, you know, have different dialogues. There's a Jivaka Sutra, you know, which is interesting, because Yutok, you know, his later incarnations was a vegetarian. And in the Jivaka Sutra, Jivaka is asking the Buddha, you know, so you shouldn't let your disciples be eating meat and these things. And it seemed like he was also kind of a proponent of vegetarianism.
Sure.
So, you know, you can trace this interesting kind of continuity.
I didn't hear that story. Really? He was scolding Buddha about that?
Well, he was more asking, so, you know, why are you allowing the monks to eat meat? And that's when the Buddha gave the teaching, oh, you know, it can't be killed deliberately for the person. There's all these rules that, you know, as a monk, you're going and collecting alms, and so you just have to accept whatever's given to you.
That's right. That's the main reason.
But you can't, you know, they can't kill a chicken for you because, oh, the monks are here, let's chop a chicken's head off and then...
Yeah, if they tell you, you have to leave and say, no, thank you.
But it seems Jivaka, he was kind of a lay practitioner that was, you know, not into the eating of meat.
Sure.
So it's an interesting thing.
Well, the Jains argued against Buddha because the Jains were into, like, they were mad that Buddha was letting his monks, or actually insisting that they accept meat if they didn't know it was coming and it was all the people had.
Right, yeah,
but they just had to accept whatever they were given, as long as it wasn't poison, right?
Yeah, and so Jivaka was the doctor for the original Buddhist community. And then his teachings, you know, got established within the Buddhist monastic community. They went to Thailand. Actually, the Thais believe that Jivaka went to Thailand and established Thai medicine.
Uh-huh.
But so he became a patron of medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's old texts in Pali that have his recipes and his kind of case studies and these things. So then in the 8th century was the first Yutok, you know, who was, you know, this incredible master of medicine. Then again in the 12th century was the second Yutok.
I see.
And Yutok really systematized.
So the first one at Takshashila was?
That was Jivaka.
Jivaka, right.
Yeah.
Okay. So and the Yutok is incarnation of Jivaka.
Yeah.
You have to understand that in the Indian and Tibetan world, different people are incarnating all the time. And that they, like the lamas that I used to translate for an interreligious dialogue, they always had a terrible time with the Christian doctrine of, like, God only having the one son. And the one time and the one culture. They just couldn't imagine that. And they would say things like, but how many children do you have? Oh, five, you know, to some theologian. And then they would say, but God is omnipotent and he can only have one? And it would go like that. Because they have this idea that the enlightened beings are so omnipresent and so powerful. And they're always emanating to help people all over the place, all the time. Mm-hmm. And that there's this one geisha that we know in Virginia who passed away now. But he was a very, very holy person, really, kind of. And he was also a great teacher, logically and academically as well. And his students once were in a very positive mood, and they were thinking, what a great teacher, we're so lucky to have him. And then they asked him, they said, Keshala, you're so wonderful, and such a great teacher, how come you're not a reincarnation? And he said, well, I wanted to be, he said, but all the good ones were taken. Because somebody already was incarnating, you know, all the famous ones, you know, like, they're already incarnated all over Tibet and everywhere. So that I didn't realize that Jivaka was, that Yutok is considered incarnation of Jivaka.
Yeah,
that's
so
totally cool.
In Yutok's Namtar, in his biography, they say he was Jivaka and also Gampopa.
Oh, really?
So, yeah, there's a few, those were the main ones, because Gampopa was also a doctor.
Yes, he was, that's right. Now, was Gampopa after the second Yutok, or was he before the second Yutok?
I think he was before the second
Yutok.
What year
is it? Before, yeah, a little bit in between, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
But, you know, the main ones are the two Yutoks, and then they very frequently also speak of Jiva.
Right.
But so Yutok, especially the second one in the 12th century, really put together all of the streams of Tibetan medicine,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is indigenous medicine of Tibet, Indian Buddhist medicine and Ayurveda that, you know, then got translated, especially when the Muslims invaded. In India, there was a lot of, you know, things, texts and traditions were getting lost, so there was a big migration north. So there was a big push to translate this information to Tibetan. So you have Rinchen Tsongpo, about 1,000 years ago, translated a lot of important medical texts and so on. So there was a lot of this huge transmission of Indian wisdom and a lot of it, you know, Ayurvedic medicine going to Tibet. And then there was Chinese medicine, Greek medicine, Mongolian medicine, and all kind of converged. And the Tibetan kings were patrons of that. They would sponsor these conferences, and they would, you know, make these incredible, this incredible syncretic system. And so Jivaka was the one that really finalized and, you know, kind of codified the system of medicine. And he has, you know, his medical teachings, and then he has a special spiritual path called the Yutok Nintik, which is the meditation practice, the spiritual path that Tibetan doctors followed, which is also a very interesting and unique tradition within Tibetan Buddhism also. So that's Yutok.
Any questions? People have questions? Particular points of interest? Yes.
So when you say the medicine Buddha mantra, what exactly is happening in terms of the transmission of energy?
Medicine Buddha mantras in general are considered to be kind of seed syllables, right? And evoking the presence of Medicine Buddha and the energy of that. And the energy of Medicine Buddha, isn't it? It's the energy of the nature of ultimate reality. Because how is ultimate reality known by a Buddha? In which when we know something, in our normal way of knowing, we think we know it when I like, that's a plastic brick under that little camera. So I think I know it because I know the names of the bricks and the camera. So I sort of know what it is, meaning I put my label on. But deep knowing of something is almost like a subject-object merger knowing. So a Buddha knows reality by being reality, something like that, this idea. And reality, because and that means and reality being infinite, then that being becomes infinite. A Buddha's Dharmakaya, as they call it, or body of reality, is an infinite thing. Which is something inconceivable. I mean, that sounds like a word, but it doesn't. Infinite. The word infinite doesn't really land anywhere. It's a negational word. You know, negational words in general, like emptiness, infinite, they don't land on anything. They fail to find a boundary, and they just keep going, and things like that. And in a way, they know, on the other hand, that the distance they're going is infinite, and therefore they'll never get there. So they have to realize they're already there in a funny kind of a way. So the only way you know reality or emptiness, like some people will go around saying, I know emptiness, or I realize that I had an experience of emptiness, and actually some scholars will talk about that. But that's just a mode of speech, because really how you know ultimate reality is you melt into it. And how do you melt into it? You melt into it through bliss. The experience of melting into something is a blissful experience. It's an expansion of boundary and a bliss melt. It's something like a bliss melt. Actually, the Buddhists, in the esoteric world, they connect it to the experience of orgasm, actually. But it's far more than an ordinary one. It's like a total universal orgasm, something like that. So since that's the case, then that mantra is said to be conveying the presence of that kind of awareness. So when one recites that mantra, one is both invoking the medicine Buddha thought of as another, as a different being. And then one, but because of invoking, the being that comes from those seeds is a being that doesn't think they're different, that feels they're the same as you. So then what you might call inner medicine Buddha is your own healing energy of your own mind. And then I think the secret medicine Buddha is going to be that inner feeling as a bliss melt. Something like that. So if you could say like a medicine Buddha mantras without passing out, you might melt. Something like that. But in the lesser form of that, you will embody, you will feel one with the presence of that healing energy. And actually that's the ambition of this place, by the way. When my wife, who knows more than I do about whatever it is, when we started working here as the unpaid caretakers of His Holiness's place, which we're honored to be, I shouldn't sound like I'm complaining. I do have a day job. yes, when we did, I'm retiring soon, luckily. When she said she wanted the place to be such that just setting foot across the boundary onto the property, someone would feel much better. And things would look really helpful and healthful, everything, wherever they looked. It would be reverberating to them the positivity of the environment. And we actually had a person, we had a person who was in the New York Philharmonic violinist, a Korean woman, Korean-American woman. Marvelous, tall, beautiful woman who played, I think, second violin in the New York Philharmonic. But she was on leave, sick leave, because something happened where her hearing became so sensitive that any sound disturbed her deeply. It was like painful to hear anything. She went around with like earplugs, you know, and even that vibrations would get her, you know. And then some idiot doctor sent her to Maryland to a place where the U.S. Army hospital treats shell shock. Oh my God. And then they put some waves in her brain and made it far worse, and she was in agony. So she showed up here. She was all up here, and she couldn't even sit in a class like this. I mean, and I was talking in a gentle voice because she said I wasn't her usual semi roaring voice. And then Sharon Salzberg was also here, was talking very quietly the way she does. But she couldn't even take that. But then she went and she was wandering around. And I was very worried about her, and I had an appointment to see her the next morning. And that afternoon when we were having a class, she went down to the stream. She had an intuition. She went down to this little stream, which is a trickle in the summer. Not a big roaring stream. And she just sat there and she listened to the water trickling over little pebbles, very small sound. And this sound became bearable to hear. Mm-hmm. And then she could feel the little breeze in the leaves. And then that was bearable to hear. And by the next morning, she was on a road toward being able to hear things. And she had this appointment. I was saying, I'm so worried. Maybe you shouldn't be here. Maybe we could do something. She says, no, I want to stay here for 3 months. She said, the place itself, it's a magic place, this place, really. It really is. And it somehow magically came into the possession of His Holiness the Dalai Lama. I think it's really wonderful. For us, you know, he doesn't have any use for it, for us, for the human being. So anyway, that's the ambition of the place. So, okay, let's say that mantra then. Do you want to say that? Any more questions?
Right. I have a question.
Yes.
You
have to speak louder.
Is that equivalent to when they speak of the non-self, the experience of the non-self?
Well, I don't really like non-self, because it sounds like some alien or something. Selfless, self-experience of selflessness. Mm-hmm. Yes, the experience of selflessness, though, is experienced by a self.
Right, so that's my second part of my question. Once you have awareness of that, aren't you back to
self? But the self that experienced it is the relational self, which is the only one that was ever there. the only self that isn't there, that is the target of negation, the negative expression selflessness or non-self, but selflessness is better, is a absolute self, an unchanging, non-relational, fixed, independent, self-subsistent, intrinsically identifiable, intrinsic identity that's sort of always you, you know, like the one dog tag, the immortal soul dog tag, you know, that never changes. That never was there, but because we feel it's there, we kind of struggle with our relational experiences. That's a source of suffering, according to Buddhist analysis. That sort of psychotic idea of the unenlightened person who thinks there's something that they're not, that isn't even there, actually. Something like that. So that's what selflessness is. And so the thing, but then this relates to, there is a problem here. I bet you do Bhikkhante, don't you?
Depends on the context.
Oh, you don't mind? Oh, good. I'm a little bit heretical here, myself, personally. Because Tibetans have a thing that when you, which they get from India, that when you receive a mantra from your teacher, you have to pronounce it the way your teacher did, whether it's right or wrong, or it's something won't transmit. And I think that, and Tibetans can't pronounce some sounds of Sanskrit. They're not good in multi-consonant clusters, for example, Tibetans. And there are certain sounds they are not good at, so they don't pronounce them well. I think we should pronounce them in the Sanskrit way, personally, I always do. So there's Medicine Buddha Mantra. Do you want to recite it together then, or do you have anybody else have any other question that we do? Then we'll recite a few times, and then we'll break, because it's at a little after 9, we'll break, as you have to get up at 7 to do Lejang, morning yoga, healing yoga. So. Where are you doing that? The yoga center?
I believe we're doing it here.
Okay, in this room. Okay, fine.
Yeah, so 7 o'clock.
Okay.
Tibetan yoga.
Good. You ready for Medicine Buddha Mantra, everybody? 10? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, how many of you know it already? Well, if you do, and you heard it a certain way, please say it the way you heard it. The way I say it is, I don't say tayata. Sometimes they say this tayata, Tibetans. But you know what tayata means? Tayata means as follows. It means, in Sanskrit, it means as follows. And it's put before a mantra, meaning the mantra follows. So it's not part of the mantra. The mantra begins with om. And om is made up of three sounds. Ah, u, m is om. Because o is ah plus u. Short ah plus or short u is o. Okay? O. So, and the ah is the body of all Buddhas, the u is the speech of all Buddhas, and the is the mind of all Buddhas. Ah, u, um. So, om celebrates and resonates as the seed of the total presence of infinite numbers of enlightened beings in every subatomic particle wave function. Okay, so om is the first thing. Okay, om, say om.
Om.
Bhaisajya.
Bhaisajya.
And that's spelled Bhaisajya. Bhaisajya. But Tibetans say Bhikkhante. The sha sound, they go ka. And they blame the Bengalis.
Yeah, a lot of North Indians do that.
They do. So they, but anyway, sha is, because the sha is almost.
Yeah.
Sha, like that, Bhaisajya. But it isn't really ka. There is a word, there is itself a letter ka. There's not a big ka. But never mind. Well, and I think, but the sha is more soft and gentle. Sha than ka.
This sha?
Well,
sha.
Sha, yeah. Sha. Okay, sha. It's a sha, it's a fluid sound. You know, sha. Bhaisajya. Okay. Om Bhaisajya, Bhaisajya. Say. Om Bhaisajya Bhaisajya. Maha Bhaisajya.
Maha
Bhaisajya. Bhaisajya
Raja.
Bhaisajya
Raja.
Samudgate.
Samudgate.
Swaha.
Swaha.
Om Bhaisajya Bhaisajya.
Om Bhaisajya Bhaisajya.
Maha Bhaisajya.
Maha Bhaisajya.
Bhaisajya Raja.
Bhaisajya Raja.
Samudgate Swaha.
Samudgate Swaha.
Swaha means all hail. Bhaisajya means medicine. Bhaisajya Bhaisajya. Maha Bhaisajya means great medicine. Bhaisajya Raja means medicine king. Samudgate means rise up. Like get it together and rise up. You know, come here, sort of thing, or you know, do it, something like that. Someone got the swaha. Swaha means all hail. Or it can mean all hail or all is well, as my mother always used to say after family tiffs. All is well, it ends well. That's used to say it all the time anyway. Okay. Om Bhai Satya Bhai Satya.
Om Bhai
Satya. Maha Bhai Satya.
Bhai
Satya Raja. Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Satya Bhai Satya. Maha Bhai Satya. Bhai Satya Raja. Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Satya. Now let's all do it together. Bhai Satya. Let's do it together. Om Bhai Shanja, Bhai Shanja, Maha Bhai Shanja, Bhai Shanja, Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shanja, Bhai Shanja, Maha Bhai Shanja, Bhai Shanja, Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shanja, Bhai Shanja, Maha Bhai Shanja, Bhai Shanja, Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Come on now, guys, your lips are not moving. Come on, don't be lazy. Don't be lazy. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Come on, do it. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Raja. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhya Deswaha. Actually, thank you. By it's going more, taking the shut more in back of the mouth, it comes closer to the my guru's way of saying. I feel more virtuous now. Thank you, Eric. Okay, so by going like that, and the bhai is with an H, you know, that's that Indian sound that some of you may be difficult. Because all our consonants are aspirated in English, like T, there's a H with it. But B, it's not that aspirated, but bah, bah, bhai shajja, like that, bhai shajja. Okay,
and
so now bedtime, I think. Would you have some final
comments? No, I was just going to say the samudgate and samungate, that's just the Tibetan not able to write the D kind
Yeah, right.
So it's,
well, they
it's
say
just
samud,
a,
no, I even forgot that they said that.
Yeah.
I thought samud, they could
tell. Yeah.
Udgate.
Yeah.
Ud means up.
Yeah.
Sam means totally.
Yep.
Gate means totally up gone. Mm. No, you can't go right away.
You
right
can't
yet.
Be up gone.
She wants to go. You were because you were lazy, didn't you? Okay, practice it. You see, you know, you all learned vipassana. A lot of you have done vipassana, right? Mindfulness. I bet a lot of you have. You know, and then, you know, you count your breath 1 to 10, and then back to 1, you know, and then you mind wanders off, then you bring it back, you know. So actually, mantra meditation is very, when you do meditating, you do it very murmuring. The word japa means kind of murmuring. Actually, Alex famous to translate muttering. It's a little silly, but murmuring is good. It's, you murmur it so that your mind doesn't scatter with the loud noise. And then that creates a stream, and you get where you can inhale while continuing the stream, you know, and when you have to inhale. But also it slows your breathing down because, you know, you're saying more as you go along. And you then you have the same thing where when you get really used to it, your mind will wander even though you're saying but your mind will wander and you'll think about breakfast or whatever, lunch or dinner, or why am I doing this? And you bring it back. So you bring it back into the mantric stream. And at the same time, you're evoking the healing, you know, sapphire blue barrel light of the medicine Buddha, this blue light that heals. That is the sort of bliss energy of the healing, deep, dark, blue light of healing. Like Doctor Who's TARDIS. It's a blue light like Doctor Who's TARDIS. And so So you have a double, they're very pragmatic. You have a twofer or a threefer when you use a mantra to develop more concentration and more mindfulness, instead of just the breath, The breath is very good too, but mantra is really good to do that with. Okay, so if you have a final comment before we break?
No.
Okay, well, but what I do, that is Menla sleeping yoga, because you're going to go to sleep now. And Menla sleeping yoga is that if you remember from your reading of the Book of the Dead, I'm assuming many of you are advanced, and you've read about the 8 stages of dissolution, earth into water, water into fire, fire into wind, wind into constance, constance into luminance, luminance into radiance, radiance into immanence, immanence into clear. Those 8 stages. So Menla sleeping yoga is remembering what you can remember of those 8, and if you don't remember, make a note of them from one of the books, Book of the Dead Introduction, or something else. And just think of yourself as slowly settling into a white light, a reddish warm light, a cool white light, a reddish warm light, and an embracing dark light. And then letting yourself conk out in sleep, but not thinking of yourself as lying in sleep in a dark nothing, but just saying that now I'm, by going in dark and letting go of my sense of subjectivity, by turning off my sense, by dropping out from my sense stimuli, I am actually allowing myself to just be one with the universe. And that then brings me, without my having a dualistic subject-object awareness of it, it allows me to melt into the clear light of bliss. And so where I'm going to be sleeping tonight, I'm going to be my body and every cell in my body, but my mind is going to be just not bothering to be aware of it. I'm going to be immersed in the infinite energy of the clear light of bliss. And that's why when I wake up, coming back up from the dark light, sunlight, moonlight, into my ordinary sense organ body, flesh and blood sense organ body, I'm going to feel really refreshed and ready to go to morning healing, Tibetan healing yoga. Okay? That's Menla sleeping yoga. Okay? Good night. Thank you very much.